Hi everyone, welcome to the first installment of the LRUF podcast. My name is Tarek Haldi, this is Joseph Tuma.
Guys.
Thomas Alexander Shaliba.
Shaliba?
Shaliba. Shaliba. And Captain Kareem Jamal.
Yeah.
So.
Say hello to the people.
What?
Say hello to the people.
So, currently
at
a very nice establishment in London called Raison D'etre. And our fine host Matthieu is taking care of us, providing us with cookies and refreshments.
A lot of cookies.
So, on to business. We're going to talk about the current affairs in rugby, talk a little bit about the LRUF situation, and just news in general, really, and just have a chat, effectively. So, Tuma, kick it off with the subjects, mate.
Hey, welcome, guys. Welcome to our new podcast. Right. Let's, first of all.
So professional, I love it.
Right. So, let's start off with. What's going on in Lebanon, boys? Rugby-wise, I don't know. Mr. Social Media Rep here. Give us an update of how many followers you've got.
Instagram's pushing 1,200.
Give him the tag,
At Lebanon Rugby, no big deal.
Down, link there.
Subscribe here.
Link will be like around here.
Get 10% off.
Yeah, if you guys get a chance, give us a follow on social media. We're really trying to push forward with that, just trying to broaden our sort of reach. So in Lebanon, schools rugby is kind of a big focus of ours at the moment. We're trying to get sort of a kids' domestic league sorted out to be like a repetitive theme for every season. Hopefully, get a few tournaments in between now and summer, and then when the sort of new school year rolls around, they'll have a fully functioning season going for them, so it should be good.
So what we've got currently, Cage, you're probably the best man to know what's going on domestically.
As of recently, I know that USG are looking to put a team for next season.
USG
University.
So it's
University of San Jose.
Oh, San.
They're looking to be part of the club.
USJ.
And it's going to be coached, I think.
No,
and
run.
French G.
It's going to be coached and run.
USJ.
Is there a problem to Joseph? What's the question? J and G.
Yeah.
My French act dialect, don't I? So it's going to be coached and run by, till now, Laurent Zaloum. Obviously, he was a Jamhur player.
Great guy.
He's coming back to Beirut from Canada, and obviously he wants to take a more central role. And as Jamhur has already been an established club, he wants to start with a club that's new and bring it up. So he's going to take control of that. So that's what's going on with it. As for a new club, as for next year, then I think all the same old teams are going to stick around: Jamhur, Beirut, Junior, Green Gores.
Okay.
Yeah.
Cool. And then we'll have now this side of the new year, this side of the season, UNIFIL games.
The usual suspects. So UNIFIL games, tens tournaments, sevens tournaments when we can get it in. Obviously, it all depends mostly on the situation of Lebanon.
Yeah.
Usually if the country's doing well and it's a bit safer, we can attract countries or clubs to come over and play these tournaments.
Yeah. So I mean, there used to be a wasn't there a sort of Beirut tens tournament which was held, which had like guys from Egypt coming over and other teams.
Yeah, I think, well, I remember the first time I played in the Beirut Tennis Tournament was back in 2006, and we had we had Egypt, we had a UN team, we had Cyprus team come over, we had two or three clubs based in Lebanon. We had about 10 clubs participating, and it was at the Lebanese University,
yeah.
And it was a big event. We had a lot of people come down. It was music, food, and it was really good. And then obviously, as the years went by, I think leagues started progressing in universities. That started got a lot more attention with the boys that were playing rugby.
Yeah.
And obviously with the situation that happened in Lebanon, you obviously had the 2006 war, then you had the civil problems in 2012, was it? Civil issues, mm-hmm. Was it 2012? These things takes up a lot of time. And obviously a lot of the countries that we invite, or the clubs that we invite, they're not funded very well, so it all depends on players paying their own trip and paying their own.
Yeah.
It's a lot of things to deal with for clubs to do or commit once or twice a year, especially with the other international commitments they have.
Yeah,
but there's still a lot going on then to the end of the season, and then
everything now is going to be leading up to the international season.
Yeah, so obviously we have that ARC, which is...
So that leads nicely into that. So end of March, Uzbekistan.
Yeah, Uzbekistan. So we've obviously got the...
It's our annual international 15s tournament, basically.
Yeah, basically. So ARC, Asian Rugby Championship, this year is going to be held in Uzbekistan. Originally, we were going to be us, Uzbekistan, Iran, and Qatar. But as we understand, Qatar have now pulled out.
Yeah, so they've officially pulled out. Reasons, I don't know, I didn't ask. Doesn't really make a difference right now.
It's a shame, really.
They don't travel well, Qatar.
No, I mean, well, they're a bunch of guys. A lot of guys just working there, and they're there to work. Like, there's probably to be visa difficulties as well.
Mm.
But it is a shame, because, I mean, I'd definitely like to give them a run for their money. Like,
yeah, very close competition,
such
actually.
A close game, like, and it's good competition. Like, it is, like, obviously, we left on bad terms with them, but they are a nice enough bunch of guys to play against. Like, you know, it's like...
They're the only team to ever have beaten us in a...
In an international competition.
Yeah.
Yeah, so obviously in seven years, we've only lost against...
Yeah, so our only two losses are to Qatar.
Is there only three losses?
In the Asian Rugby Championship.
Yeah.
Which is frustrating, but...
No, in the ARC, correct.
So they'd probably be replaced with Jordan.
So it'd either be Jordan or Pakistan, as far as I know.
Okay. Good to play against Pakistan again, actually.
And what will happen is, obviously, we will go first seeds, automatically. So we wouldn't play Uzbekistan first game. We would either play Jordan or Pakistan, whatever team comes in. And
it's quite a level playing field, that.
Yeah, because Jordan, obviously... We played them 2015. I think we've been quite comfortably there, but
they're completely different squad now.
Went quite far to the semis, I think.
They definitely got a bigger player pool than they had a couple of years back.
Yeah, so they're definitely forced to be reckoned with.
Yeah.
And Uzbekistan, I understand they've got pumped with a lot of money now. They've got a few boys playing in the Russian leagues.
Yeah, they've got a big. Sort of push for domestic rugby at the moment, and they've got a lot of external coaches coming in, and
they're big lads as well, man.
Yeah, they're massive guys, and I think with a little bit of technical teaching, they'll be.
But we've been playing Uzbek since 2011, and like you can see the step change in their pedigree and in their technical like and skill levels.
Yeah, I mean,
it's
like
stepped up massively to when we last played them in 2014.
We actually played them last year in Malaysia.
Did you?
Well,
no, none of us were there, were they?
No.
When we played them in 2014, I was impressed within 3 years that they could progress.
Yeah, I mean, like, and that went down to the last kick of the game.
And that was literally the last kick of the game.
Yeah, it was tight. It was tight. I mean, they're 10 big guys.
Ivan Dragon.
Pop a face up, Tarek.
I'll be a face popping up right here.
But I'm not sure what I was speaking to, but I'm not sure if it was one of the Asian rugby guys. But apparently, Gaith might have been telling me that. It might be Ronnie. Like Russia basically wanted more teams to compete with, basically, and they're actually helping fund some of Uzbekistan stuff. Yeah. Trying to build up the player pool there, so they've got some.
Well, I know. So well, that Ivan, the 10, he actually played in the. He was actually in the Russian league. I think the biggest benefit that Uzbek were getting was that their whole squad from the first time we played them to the last time we played them. Not many players have changed.
No, it's the same boys.
It's exactly the same boys, except for maybe one or two have added to the squad.
And they're good lads.
So they're obviously training together or playing with it. So that consistency makes a difference. But if you look at our team, except for like a certain core of players, you know, we've had a big jump of players from 2011 or 12 to last year, for example.
Yeah.
You know, and not just a different number of players. You know, 2012, we had two players playing in the forwards, but now they're playing in the back line.
Yeah.
You know, it's mixed up completely. It's that obviously that
I think we are starting to get a solid base of core base of players.
Yeah.
And core sort of
it was like we were talking about last week. There's always that solid sort of Lebanese contingent. So all the guys who are based in Lebanon, they're sort of always featuring in the side. And it's half to two thirds of the side were just Lebanese guys.
Yeah.
And then there's obviously a lot of filler, as with a lot of others in international teams, lots of filler guys come in, like us from the UK and then guys from Australia and stuff. But it seems as though it's getting into a repetitive theme.
Yeah, I get that.
That's good. Yeah, we're definitely getting into a kind of playing style. We've got a solid pack now, solid set piece, which you boys can play off.
Until 2013 we didn't have that.
So that's
I think what we benefited a lot internationally from, especially our forward game, is that we brought in a lot of boys. Not, I wouldn't say brought in a lot of boys, but we brought in a few players who played overseas, where in Australia and England and even Canada. And what they bring to the game is something that's new to what the Lebanese forwards are used to, which is some
grit.
Some grit to the play.
Yeah.
Some dark arts to it. Some things that if you haven't been around the game of rugby since you were 8 or 9 years old, you wouldn't really pick it up. And bringing that into the squad has helped develop the whole team tremendously. So that's one thing that we should be happy with for that.
Yeah, that's good.
I'm still under 400 calories for the night, though, aren't I?
Yeah, of course you are.
Jesus. You can follow Mike Fitzpal. Jamal.
Yeah, cool. All right. So
that should be a topic we should talk about. Diet and all that. Like, you know what we do is injury.
Wait, let me just get my top off, and everyone just. Yeah,
oh okay. Goodness. No one has seen me with my top off.
Don't do drugs, kid. Just telling you.
Oh, it's about drugs, shall we?
Drugs.
Yeah. Why?
What?
Oh.
Who's in the press
room? We'll come back to that later.
By the way.
Stick around, though. So, just finished off on the international, we've got sevens tournament coming up as well.
Yeah.
So, this is interesting. So, this is in Qatar.
Of all places.
Again, yeah, of all places. Funnily enough, Qatar attended that one. This is the Asian development series. So how this works is it
the development one?
Mm. Yeah. So this is, remember we played in Chennai and Alliance.
That wasn't development.
I thought it was Arab Sevens.
That wasn't their development squads for like Philippines and it wasn't their development squad. One of the
not a development squad. The tournament is called the development series.
Oh, sorry.
So
okay.
It doesn't include Japan. Like
okay,
the guys who are in the main series.
Okay, I thought you meant like development squad. Obviously, I was there.
So basically, how it works: you got the main Asian series. Which has got top teams like Japan, Hong Kong, Korea, Sri Lanka.
Yeah.
So there's 8 spots available for that. There's a relegation and a promotion to the development series, which is what we're competing in.
Okay.
So in the development series, in the development series, there's us, Philippines, whoever's come down from the one above. It's like, I think Singapore has come down this year. Taipei won it last year.
So they go up.
So they've gone up and they stayed up.
They stayed
up. Then you've got your UAE, Qatar, India. So basically everyone in Asia.
Yeah, but the thing is, there's supposed to be 2 legs. So now they're only just doing the 1 leg.
So now we're doing the 1 leg. So there was meant to be Thailand, but that's cancelled.
Yeah, I thought they cancelled it, but looking for another location.
It's too late now.
It's too late.
So they'll probably do a bigger tournament in Qatar.
In Qatar.
So the winner of this obviously gets promoted to the main series, and then the top 2 of the main series go into the main HSBC qualifier in Hong Kong, and then
which they
do at the Hong Kong Sevens.
It's been Japan and Hong Kong recently years.
Yeah, it's always Japan and Hong Kong.
It's always been it.
Yeah.
Okay.
And I think Korea have been 1 year as well. I think they might be a repechage place as well. And then obviously Japan won it last year, so they are the main HSBC series this year.
Only in the Japan leg.
They're a core team. So the winner of Hong Kong qualifier. Then whoever became last, because Portugal have gone down. They'll go on to the Europe equivalent.
Yeah, fine.
So 2 places from Asia, and then places from all the rest of the world, and then the winner gets the core place.
Right. Okay.
So effectively, our Olympic qualification starts in Qatar.
Yeah.
And I haven't looked like proper squad team wise. What are we looking at?
Well, annoyingly, because I mean, obviously you've got a load of tournaments per year, and you've got guys from Australia and Lebanon, and all around the world, effectively. And for the most part, we're funding this off our own back. So a lot of the Australian guys who would usually be coming in as sort of first selections for sevens can't come because they can't afford it. So at the moment, we've got effectively a team of guys who could afford to come. So you've got like myself, for example.
To be fair, that catch you didn't as well, was pretty good.
It's a clip.
Have you got it on video?
The clip will be around. Nah, actually,
for anyone that...
Listen, boys, if you want someone like icon to sevens, all right, to shore up the scrums.
We can put like some random like fail video.
The two that you get for a tournament.
Yeah.
Look, I shore up the scrums, all right, I actually tackle on like a lot of those sevens. Insert video of Kareem Jamal missing a tackle.
My defense was sick on Dubai.
Why did you specify 2016 was okay. Very good. Mysterio 619. Very, very nice move.
Legs around the head flip.
And
Ball and all, mate.
So anyway, we've got a team of guys, sevens players, but we've got a few guys who, I don't know, effectively aren't sevens players, so we haven't got our best side out. So.
But I don't think it's been broadcast. Like, not you're the captain. You don't even know how important this tournament is.
It's definitely gone under the radar.
It's not being like, fair enough. It's going to be at the end of the day. Who can afford to pay or whatever like that. But I mean, this is effectively the Olympic qualification. I don't think the boys.
It's a big deal.
It's a big deal. Because we can definitely win it. Because last year we were so close.
I think people were a lot more keen on Thailand as the first leg because it was Thailand. And everyone was like, oh, well.
See, that's the wrong attitude, though.
No, I know it is, but if people are paying off their own back, they'd rather pay for somewhere they actually want to go.
That's the whole issue about people paying their own tickets. Because the thing is, when people start paying for their own ticket, all of a sudden they start saying, "Well, I want to play. Yeah. I need to play. Yeah. I paid my own trip." Or if they haven't,
that makes sense. It's perfectly fine.
Listen,
if it's an international tour and you're going to represent your country, you should know. Listen, okay. Well done for you. Tap on the back for paying your own trip. The best team starts and the best team finishes.
No.
If you leave the tournament with playing only 1 minute and the team does a good job, that happens.
But I'm saying, for example, the example of this is, Thailand is, there were two options, Thailand or Qatar.
Or Qatar, and they would rather go to Thailand.
And all the best sevens players pick Thailand. And obviously because it's a better destination.
I didn't know. I think that's a bit unfair.
And also the Australian guys are easier for them to go.
The Australians are easier to go. And also, I think the dates as well help with a lot of boys.
Because it's so close to ARC now.
To be fair, both... that's the thing. Both sevens...
Have you been named?
I can't get out. That's another challenge that we've got in our squad is that we're all full-time workers.
Yeah.
Or nearly all.
Yeah, as you would see on the Instagram account, day jobs...
Exactly. Check out the page.
Subscribe. Link on the.
So that's half the challenge. Is if you get in.
What's a job?
25 days or whatever during me a year.
Yeah, it's tough.
You can't commit the whole allowance.
I mean, for the most part, a lot of us who do work take unpaid leave.
And I've had to do that more.
I have not an issue with that, right? Because I love nothing better than playing for my country, but. It is a sacrifice.
Yeah.
So will you be playing if obviously you're going to America?
You're not down for the
chasing the dream.
So obviously the cutoff for me is obviously unanswered because obviously till now, for those who don't know at home, I'm obviously
on the brink.
Yeah, so I'm basically I'm leaving to. America on Friday. Staying in New York for a couple of days and then shooting off to San Diego. The reason for that is obviously because last year I went to San Diego to train with the pro team. Obviously they have the pro league in America that started up last year, was their first year. So I went in the last 2 weeks, I went for 2 weeks to train with them. And it was good that at the end of the 2 weeks they wanted me to stay along, stay for the rest of the season. But there was issues with the P1 visa, which is like the athlete's visa to stay in the country. I think it was the cost for the league to do and the time as well. The time it would be done, there would only be like a couple of weeks left of the season. But they told me that they wanted me for next season if things go well in that. So for basically the last 6 or 7 months, I've just been training to be in the best shape possibly with the cookies not Alfin.
Mate, you're allowed to
cheat. They keep disappearing.
They're protein cookies.
I've
had a couple.
I am the cookie monster.
It's really good. Like.
So the cookie situation camp. Is now, obviously, because the people who follow like So there's been a massive argument with the pro. So what's happened is the pro rugby is saying that USA Rugby are not abiding by the exclusive rights that they agreed to, and vice versa. So it's all up in the air right now. So I'm going over to San Diego anyway, because they said within the next 30 days things will be sorted about basically if the league is going to start on time.
Yeah.
If there is actually going to be a league in 2017. So I'm going out there as planned, as scheduled, and going to continue training. And if it works out, great, I'm already there. If it doesn't work out, I've got a couple of other options in Canada. But it's not obviously in the pro level, it's just a normal club. Obviously, it's playing rugby overseas, it's a bit of fun. But I've just got to play it by ear right now and just see how things go. But if obviously it doesn't work out with the pro rugby, then
but Mark, the first beginning of March, you wouldn't have been. Is it there'd be starting games then, or it's just too far?
Well, you don't. So the plan was original. The plan was that the season starts the first week of March, but pre-season starts first week or the beginning of February.
Yeah.
And obviously the season starts mid-March. Mid-March. Yeah. So either way, so I definitely wouldn't have gone to Qatar. I won't be going to Qatar if the league is on.
Yeah.
But if it's not on, then I'll be definitely going to Qatar. Bar any injuries playing any other rugby somewhere elsewhere. Metal.
Okay.
So this guy.
Move on.
What's next on the agenda?
Next on the agenda. What should we talk about next?
General.
So yeah, let's go general stuff.
Six Nations.
So something.
Outside pick.
What?
Right, you want to talk about... so we've got the Six Nations coming up. I don't think anyone's announced their squad yet.
No, it's too early. First game was...
Oh, but I heard what? Warburton's stepped down as captain.
Is he?
Is
it official, yeah?
Yeah, they did it today. They put it on the news today.
Sure.
So they're saying the favourite...
He stepped down.
Say
what?
Who'd take it? Alan Wynn?
That's what they said. He's the favourite.
He's got to be the favourite.
To be fair,
apparently he said he stepped down for captain because he's still only 28 and he just wants to prolong. Yeah,
Wales silent on Warburton. I'm just reading. This is live news.
Live news.
Yeah. No, we are the news.
The Welsh Rugby Union are refusing to comment on reports that Sam Warburton may sit down. But
BBC's lying then.
In my opinion, and I'm half Welsh, he's not been the same player since he's been captain.
No, agree.
Not tell. No, he was class in
2011.
He's had a World Cup.
Run up to that World Cup, he was class.
Ever since that tackle, he has been the same.
What, six years?
Yeah. Seriously?
6 years, yes, I'm the same.
Seriously, mate.
On Vassal Clare?
Ever since that tip tackle, he has not been the same player.
Do you hear the story that
he's been holding back?
He sat next to Vassal Clare.
Was he?
Yeah. on the flight over the World Cup.
What, did he like nudge him and say, oh, hey, mate, I usually just shovel that game, do you remember?
Yeah.
Alan Roland, most Irish name I've ever heard.
But he did well in the Lions tour.
Alan Roland.
He didn't do anything.
Yeah. One big game in the second test, and then he had his hamstring.
Yeah, that was a shame.
Yeah,
I remember Paul O'Connell's hamstring.
Oh, yeah.
Want to watch
that. That's really the moment of the week.
He's got a book out, by the way.
Who? O'Connell.
Paul O'Connell, yeah.
Can he read?
It's decent.
Can he write?
What?
Sorry, Paul.
We'll give you a plug here.
Paul, his name's Kareem Jamal. He lives.
Link to the book.
Liam Fitzgerald says
shout out. Link to the Amazon Paul O'Connell book. Yeah.
Okay, so Warburton. Yeah. To be fair, Alan Wynne Jones will probably take it.
Yeah.
And he's been captain before when Warburton's been injured and stuff.
Yeah, Alan Wynne is.
Mate, stick him on.
To be fair, I thought he was
going
to
be about Lydia.
Who?
Lydia.
Psycho.
Come on, give me some shit.
Insert clip.
Insert Lions clip here.
Yeah,
oh, classic. I got time for it.
That is
funny.
It's good. Yeah. So as a Welshman, if you had three people to choose from, and you being basically half Welsh now that your wife is
married Welsh, I know.
So if you had picked three people to be contention for the captaincy, who you got? So you got Alan Wynne up there.
Alan, it's definitely. Hibbard's not in the squad.
What?
No, he won't be in the squad.
Has he retired from international rugby, Hibbard?
He's cut his hair.
Maybe, but he's not going to be in the squad. Anyway.
Bigger will probably fancy his chances.
Oh, no, it's going to be 100% Alan Wynne.
He will. Bigger will fancy his chances.
Yeah, he'll fancy his chances, but he doesn't deserve it.
I wouldn't even put Warburton starting. Tipperick is on fire.
Standby.
I read a stat today. Tipperick has made 160 tackles without missing one.
Like Falatau, he must be there.
This season.
Oof.
That's amazing.
Without missing one.
Is that his stats or my stats?
What tackles missed?
Probably go past.
Say again.
Tackle was missed.
That's a big start.
That's a big start.
You had to make a stat vacation.
How's that cookie, mate?
Well, as I said, the cookie, bro.
Sign the contract.
Cheat day.
All right.
Okay.
Falatau, mate.
So,
I feel like Falatau is the kind of guy.
He's a silent warrior.
He's a silent warrior. Yeah. Exactly right. Yeah. He's one of them that will just lead
by. Friendly Polynesian style, just keeps himself quiet. Yeah.
He'll lead by his performance. He's not the kind of guy that would be rallying the troops if they're, you know, in a challenging situation in a game.
Calling him stupid?
Not at all. Calling him quiet.
And I think, like, Lydia would be too much banter around the squad that he can't be captain, couldn't be too serious.
Lydia, I think, is injured at the minute. Anyway.
Yeah, he's.
He's out for the Six Nations. My back row would be Moriarty, Tipperick, and Falatau. At the moment.
Okay.
See, I don't even know that player, that Moriarty.
I don't know.
Yeah, he's
from
Gloucester.
You know Moriarty.
Tattoos. Yes.
Ross Moriarty.
Yeah. Very good.
He's not full Welsh, though, is he?
I don't know. I think so.
Like you, really? Half Jap.
you can't say Jap, man.
What?
Half Far Eastern.
Japanese.
It's like saying half Leb. It's not racist, though.
Wait,
nah. If he was actually Asian and I said half Chinese and he was actually Japanese, that's racist.
All right, relax. To be fair,
comment below.
With Wales, there's only really Alan Wynne that you'd have down as captain.
Or Geoffrey Jenkins.
Because someone like Jamie Roberts is now fringe, like on the brink.
Yeah.
Well, yeah, he didn't even know if he's going to be playing that much for the way he's playing.
Reece Webb's back, like, you know, he's got a good challenge behind him. With
he's injured as well.
Is he?
Yeah.
Wales in trouble.
If they are.
Jonathan Davis.
Wooden Spoon? Question mark?
Yeah, Gat.
George North, that's not a talking point.
Oh, wow.
George North, Jesus.
What, George Lights Out North? Mate, why is he still playing?
Wait, we need a trouble week just for you. So the bands that you're hitting, it's not going well. George Lights Out North.
That wasn't meant to be bands, he's always lights out. It's a genuine concern.
Well, the last one wasn't a knockout, wasn't it? The last one wasn't a knockout.
He lay down, face down into the grass, and he said because he was worried he'd hurt his neck.
Which is fair comment.
He was like this, like.
But if you're in that position where you feel like, if you feel like that there's like a bit of twinge or something, you just stop.
It's
just
when you see boxers get knocked out, right? And like, they pull a stiffy before they go down.
Oh.
No, not boner. But no, as in like, when they get knocked out, their whole body goes stiff. Because
no, they just go like,
no. As in.
Yeah, but they do that with their hands.
Yeah, but you're like, what, do a thriller dance? No, but like their little nose chasing their legs will like go stiff, and that's what he did. Well, the second he came down from that, his whole body just went rigid. That's knockout.
He's definitely got.
And you were saying, why doesn't he wear a scrum cap?
It's
not about his head. He's got obviously like an Achilles heel, or so to speak. That he.
Well, once you've had one,
at
yeah,
the wrong, the wrong type of knock or the wrong type of whiplash, is. Is knocking him out or paralysing him or whatever.
Yeah.
It's very dangerous.
If something happens, that's
So what have they done? Have they said that he has to be off rugby for a certain amount of time?
No, he's playing. He hasn't had a week off.
Oh, he's still playing?
Yes.
He had a week off, but he
had 1 week
last week.
He's passing his concussion test.
So obviously it's not a concussion.
Mate. So it goes even bigger than things like this, because you've got massive lawsuits happening in America now with the NFL.
Oh, mate. Let's not get onto that.
Oh, we have to, because it's all relative, because that could set a precedent for you know, you've got ex-players suing the NFL because
of even
concussion.
No, yeah, but that's different.
The refs are regulating high tackles now.
This is on the topic, mate.
Listen, for the NFL, they're taught from young age to tackle with their head. This is why they're so much damage.
Head to head, you're done. You can't tackle with your head.
Seriously, in the NFL,
they're taught to head to head.
And head to serious and stuff like
that. Yeah, that's the point of tackle.
I'm pretty sure in the NFL, forgive me if I'm wrong, a head to head tackle is being like a penalty.
No. You can use your head.
You can use your head. They're taught to.
The line of scrimmage, they're like straight to head to head.
They're straight to head. They're taught to do head to head. That's why the film, if you ever watch the film Concussion.
They do this. Like, grab my shirt. Yeah, and then they go literally like.
Oh, they're
Ubering
it.
It's like straight into that. But
have you watched the film Concussion? Will Smith. It says on that from the age that they start, kids, they're taught to hit with their head.
Seriously. But anyway, let's move on to how it affects rugby.
Yeah.
So basically, if it happens in the NFL, it's going to set a precedent.
Yeah.
That players are going to sue clubs, and NFL has a lot of money. Some of the NFL clubs can probably handle, you know, a couple of million. But imagine a rugby player sues Yeah, the club's gone.
Is there not some sort of like disclaimer in their contract?
Yeah, that's, of course, there should be.
That's what's going to start happening. They're going to start to have waivers and stuff like that.
Oh, yeah.
But the problem is, obviously, we all play rugby. We know the risks of playing rugby.
Yeah, it's not tiddlywinks, it's a ton of
Well, so, but so do the people who play NFL.
Yeah, no, but the problem is, especially in the case of George North, if he's getting advised by the club, so if he plays and then he gets injured again and is found out that the club gave him wrong medical advice and they put him in,
they have his best interest.
Yeah, they made him play a game when he should have had 3 or 4 weeks off. That's when he's going to sue.
They'll all lose their license.
Yeah, exactly.
Well, it's a massive risk to not only George North but to Northampton Saints. So it's a really,
all it's
going
to
really
take is one guy to sue, and
he's such an asset. He's such an asset to the club, and I'm sure they pay good money for him and do pay good money for him. It's one of them where it's the risk they're going to have to manage.
Let's not focus on George North for too long, too much longer. It's all the time. But what we should talk about is the new laws
that's come out.
So I played a match since the new law came in, and I'll be honest, it really did slow down the game massively.
Why?
Because every single tackle, like hard, say for example you're taking into contact and you dip into the tackle.
Yeah.
Naturally, the person who's already set himself at a certain level to tackle you is instantly higher.
Yeah.
So he's got that sort of flailing arm out, ready to sort of wrap up, and it catches you on the neck or on the side of the head or something like that, and he misses the tackle, or it makes the tackle, but you've got like a sort of scrag tackle.
Did it affect the way you played? Did you consciously go in? Did you?
Yes. No, we were told by the coaches to actually be more like
aware of it.
And
why didn't you just tackle lower then?
No, the thing is, that's what they're trying to make it.
The point of the law.
That's the point. It's to make it safer. But the referee was blowing up every single tackle that was remotely higher than that would have probably got you, would have got away with no problem.
Yeah, but these are probably these. It's like a couch. What they call it? Those couch.
Jobsworth.
No.
Who really taking a job seriously?
No. Yeah. Basically, the one who's. What's the term for it? Anyway, forget whatever the term is, but one of those referees who referee at a lower level, want to be the highest level,
mate,
and they just want to blow up everything.
Yeah, at this level, they have everything's recorded, mic'd up, everything. It's proper, like...
Is it being assessed?
Yeah, they're always being watched and assessed. It's professional refereeing. Like, they get paid, like, actual wage for it.
But it's...
Yeah,
it's happening in the pro rugby.
These are legit refs, and they were blowing up literally every opportunity they could get.
There was a game a couple of weeks ago, Ulster Scarlets, both had a guy in the bin. Cost also the game. Saracens last
3 weeks.
Yeah, but did you see them? So Barrett made the tackle, and Barrett came in with the second hit.
That's because Barrett. Yeah, it wasn't Barrett's fault.
No, yeah. So Barrett got red card in the game.
Yeah, they got
he has since been cleared, and Barrett's now been banned.
Yeah,
but you got three weeks from six, which is good going. To be fair,
it's not.
Okay,
it's
but
the law's a red card.
Yeah, hold on, but maybe they're just doing this. They're telling the referees and they're telling the committee, listen, first 3 weeks, first month, be hard. And then obviously, as it goes, once they get used to it, naturally just be a little bit more lenient with the situation. Like they've done with other laws.
What I don't get is
that. Like initially, when the first laws changed for the scrums, how all the referees would blow up at everything that happened, and there was free kicks after penalty.
Let's be fair,
I don't get is high tackle, it's not a new law.
It's not so much high tackle, it's head contact now.
No, but
that's always been the law.
But the rule is now, if you go into a tackle, even accidentally, if you could have slid up into the head.
Before you used to get benefit of the doubt, now you get nothing. Now it's literally just like, it's card. There's no leniency.
The rule says minimum yellow card.
That's terrible, though.
Yeah, it is.
I think if it's like...
I think it protects shorter players, though.
We always
because I think now, especially like for open sides and typically the shorter of the forwards or hookers generally, that is going to benefit them massively. If you're a 5'9", 5'10" player versus a 6'2", 6'3" player in the same position, the shorter guy, presuming he's still got the weight and the strength behind him, is probably it's an advantage to make those hits because of the low centre of gravity. It's probably easier to channel their power than a taller guy.
But the problem is, I mean, I don't know any stats, but I feel the most concussions come when people go for the tackle and they hit people's knees and stuff.
Yeah,
not really.
Yeah, they're always free tackles.
So that's why.
It's always free
tackles. That's why since the rulings come out, there have been more concussions.
Is it really?
Because people are getting caught on the side of their face and stuff like that. Saracens, what was their last game? I can't remember who they're playing against.
Yeah, but that's just technique. That's just unfortunate.
Yeah.
It's nothing to do with what, so you're saying if there was no laws, they would be tackling higher?
Yes, they would be, because they know they can get away with stuff.
Yeah, but that's not good either, though.
Yeah, I know it's not
what
good.
I'm saying, I think concussions come from hitting people's knees. Yeah, and it's not always the tackler.
Yeah, obviously it's the technique. Obviously, like 100% it's the technique. But you can't shy away from the fact that since the rules come out, there have been more concussions.
Yeah, I just think
they're not a fact.
No, but yeah. In fairness to the RFU. An IRB, to
they've
be fair, they're not scared of reviewing the rules.
No.
Like they're not scared about putting a rule in and
well,
taking it out if it doesn't work. I mean, we've seen it obviously with the scrums, they change that every year, and it's one of them where they'll review it if it has an impact on the game and on the way the game's been played, then they'll review it.
But I think for the most part, they are making the game better
and safer.
But what I'm worried about is whether they're making the game better for the viewer or better for the player. And it kind of feels as though they're trying to make it a more of a sort of free-flowing, faster game, especially with the scrum stuff.
Yeah.
But I don't understand why they have to just keep on focusing on how the viewer sees the game. Why can't they just focus on how the player wants the game to be played? Because since this rule's come out, all the players you see on Twitter, they're like, oh,
yeah.
Stop making rugby.
Stop being
soft. Whoa.
Yeah.
And obviously, it is annoying people. So you've got to think about who it's worth. Obviously, the livelihood of the players and their sort of mental health and stuff is really important.
Yeah.
But we all play knowing the rules.
Yeah,
exactly. We all played before.
You step onto the pitch knowing that anything can happen, really.
Yeah.
I mean, most of it's in your control, but a freak accident can happen.
Like, touch
wood.
Yeah. No, get that. generally, you know, union especially is a gentleman's game.
Yeah.
So ultimately,
I've never known anyone who's
nothing,
wanted to.
There's nothing stupidly malicious happening. Yeah.
Then you see these weird videos like pop up from like South America of some people like stamping someone.
Those guys just got.
And they're playing the game for the wrong reason.
Yeah, exactly.
They're playing it just
to get as a physical outlet.
It's like, you know, on the lower leagues in ice hockey, they just play just
to score. No goals. What was that?
What else we got? We got diverted. We went off a tangent on Six Nations, so I wanted to ask a couple of more questions.
Yeah, we want to go back to Six Nations.
Yeah.
We talked about Wales.
So,
let's do outside pick and reasons.
Wait, let's do. Let me. I want to. First of all, go stick on captains, Dylan Hartley.
Oh, mate, what is his problem?
Year like, and a half ban or whatever he's had.
Would you play him
today?
If you're ready to do him?
100%.
He's brilliant.
He has never stepped. Foot wrong in an English
You're
shirt.
A massive like Saints fan, isn't he?
No, it's not even about Saints.
Nah, he's brilliant.
And I'm for South Sharks are my boys, for the record.
Yeah, but you love a bit.
I'm just affiliated with Saints.
They're doing great.
South Sharks. Yeah, I love South Sharks. South till I die. But more to the point, he's never put a foot wrong in an English shirt, and never put a foot wrong as captain of England.
Never put a foot wrong in an English shirt. He got banned. He couldn't play for the Lions because he talked back to Wayne Barnes.
That was domestic.
Was it domestic?
All
yeah,
these
red cards before saying you cheat or
he's never
cheated.
Ever.
That was in the finals, Prem final.
Prem final.
Wait, how long was he banned for now? Because of his finger.
He's literally banned
the week before.
It was a joke.
And I just think it's one of them where he. First of all, we've not been blessed with a load of hookers.
Oh no, I reckon Jamie George is better. But.
Jamie George is a handy player.
Get me his
skillful player.
But I just think Hartley's, you know, he's obviously proved his putting in this unbeaten run that we're having. He's obviously got a good chemistry with Eddie Jones. Not saying that Eddie Jones hasn't reprimanded him on, like, and I'm probably stern conversations with him about his disciplinary record. But
something like over like a year.
Saints will keep him fit. He won't have match fitness, granted. But he has to be in the squad, if not starting, for me.
Would you start him, Cage?
I don't watch enough of him to really judge on it.
You'd start him.
Yeah, I like him.
I like
him, he's an enforcer.
He is. He's one of them that, like, you know...
I rate Jamie George because, like, he's not scared to, like for example, when he did that chip and chase thing.
He's had a couple.
He's not,
yeah,
he's
a baller.
He's not scared
he's a baller.
To do it. He's not scared to sort of, like, be that forward who likes to do stuff back.
Yeah. And he picks a line as well.
Yeah, and he's a decent player.
He picks a decent line. He's a different player to Dylan Hartley. The good thing about Hartley is he's got a bit of...
Cage.
Got it.
He's when the times are tough in a game and you need someone to just scrap a game out, he'd be the first one on the sheet that you'd want to do it.
Yeah.
He's got a bit of grit about him.
10 grams of sugar, isn't
it? Oh, it's just full fat.
Oh Jesus. Diet police.
He says that's a four cookie.
Well, so who's your outside pick? So I had mine for Wales. I said I'd drop Warburton.
Mine's
outside pick as well, what do you mean?
Outside choice. Like, I said I dropped Warburton.
Oh right, controversial decision.
A bit like what would you do for England if you were in charge?
Put Sips in.
Mate, Sips is for me should have been in last year.
Oh yeah.
Don't get me wrong, George
what,
Ford is a
what
talented
I know
player.
Is, right? What I want to know
but
is what has Sips done? I mean obviously he's got a bit of media presence and that. But what has he done that has made England hate him so much?
I think because he's a liability.
It's not even that he's a liability.
Well, even if he can't kick, you have Sparrow at 12, he puts it up to 10.
It's not even that
to be fair, George Ford's in, he doesn't kick either. So
yeah, it's not even that he's a liability. He's unfortunately got a reputation that precedes him. Despite him coming back from Australia, a better player, he's gone straight to sell Sharks, and with a challenging squad there, really like held them together last year.
Yeah, he proved
his weight in gold up there. In fairness, and I think Steve Diamond did an amazing job with him. So I'm really surprised. Clive Woodward's even called it. He would have had 16 12 months ago. But I think Eddie Jones is one of them where he knows what he's getting. He likes Farrell because he's a savage. And he can play 10-12 in any situation, and he kicks his goals. And then Ford's a bowler, and he's been in and out of form, but always been in pretty decent. His distribution's good. Bit of a Charlie Al Hodgson.
I think a lot of also, is I think Cipriani, he's got a bit of that Quay Cooper vibe where he's not very coachable. Is that if you try and coach him too much, you stop what he's good at, which is off the cuff, just playing what he sees. Yeah. You know,
I mean, he's a decent
player. He steps
when
he wants.
He's talented.
Exactly,
he's
a natural talent. Whereas George Ford, he's a drilled 10. You know when he's going to kick, you know when he's going to distribute, you know this.
But George Ford plays flat. He is like a child. I've tried and relate to Charlie Hodgson because he was a smaller 10 as well, wasn't he? They were both that small 10, not big in D, but had a reliable boot out of hand, read a game very well, played flat, and his distribution was on point. Which when you've got backs like, I don't know, JJ, when he's in form, trying to bring him into the game. You've got Anthony Watson when he's in form. When you've got outside backs like that, and you just need the ball to them as quick as possible in space, then you need your best passer at 10, simple as that.
Quick question.
Tell me.
Six Nations winners.
Ireland.
No chance. England have got it.
England
have got it, mate.
So I'm going to go and say, we're going to win. My boy Parise go for the
job. To be fair, I love Campagnaro as well.
Scotland.
You know what? Scotland, I thought would have had a chance last year.
I think they've actually got a chance.
But I
JP now. Wait, you got to sit tight. You saw it.
Yeah.
What about France?
Yeah, I was just going to say.
What about France?
France can't find.
How much are you paying?
obviously, I'm supporting England through and through because I'm full Lebanese.
The problem is France only turn up at home. They really struggle on.
But I do rate Scotland at home.
Scotland, Scotland have come on a lot.
Yeah.
And it probably could be between, it'll be England, Ireland, or Scotland.
You can see their pictures against
Wales,
Australia.
Wales, can't see coming up with it.
If I may intervene, I think France will show up when nobody expects them.
But that's always the way.
Good.
Yeah.
I like your
of course. Yeah. As a surprise.
Listen, I think France could do well if one, Tranduke is their 10.
Yeah.
And 12 if Fofana's fit.
Yes, if Fofana when fit.
If Fofana's fit,
best 12 in the world.
100%.
And
Tranduke at 10.
Obviously,
and who?
Fakatau.
If Teddy Thomas is back fit completely,
he doesn't come back.
Is Uge back?
He pulled his hammy, that's why he was out.
No, mate, he did some controversial. No, I'm talking about Six Nations.
Oh, shit, yeah.
Remember? No, he got. No, it was the World Cup he stopped because of his hamstring.
He stamped on someone before that.
Yeah, I'm not talking about recent.
Oh, okay.
He's decent there.
I think he's way overrated. No, Spedding.
Really much prefer Brice Doulard.
Oh, man, I hate
that fullback.
I'll even put Jules, what's his name, Palisson at 15 over Spedding.
Spedding's not. He's that entry for a long goal.
Palisson's toilet.
Nah, he's a
bad guy.
He's not. Who?
Matthieu Mildar's class. But yeah, so if Tranduke is their starting 10, which I don't know why he's not their starting 10 regularly.
Who did they start? Camille Lopez?
Yeah.
They like Lopez and they like.
Lopez.
Is Bugsy's in the mix anymore?
Who?
What's Paris saying? Paris in the back?
Who?
Paris. Who?
Yeah.
He's like the high-paid French player.
Yeah, he's on like, like on 700 grand or something.
Earth, man.
Yeah. He was on Clermont. He's been on that salary for like 3 years, though.
Yeah. He won't get it again.
Alright, another quick question.
Yeah.
Player in the tournament.
Based on
current form, right? No ifs or buts, just give me the name, that's it. Right?
Oof. Seeing how he played against
Racing,
Fofana.
Wesley Fofana, you think?
Yeah.
I I think either Conor Murray or Ben Youngs, both are in insane form at the moment, and if they carry that on, I can see them getting that player in the tournament.
Yeah. I'd like to change mine.
It's a difficult one to
say. That is.
I'd say.
I was going to say.
I only said for Florida because we're in this guy's place. If he wasn't here, I wouldn't have said him.
Mago's definitely out. I don't know if Billy would be in. Maro Tozier is always going to be there.
Yeah.
And maybe Robbie Henshaw. He's been.
Yeah, Henshaw. He's a bit of a beast.
You're picking it up.
Yeah. Well, yeah, I was going to say Billy Miapola, but he actually realised he's injured. So.
Okay.
Probably Maro Tozier.
Okay, so a quick question. Who's winning the Six Nations?
England.
With the Grand Slam?
Yeah.
England.
With the Grand Slam?
Yeah, same.
On with Ireland. So obviously England and Ireland are the last game of the Six Nations.
What's that date?
Yeah, it's the last game of the Six Nations. So that could be like a Grand Slam decider for both teams.
And if we win that, that's the record for the most undefeated games.
It's the equal. They'll equal it.
Equally, yeah, the same.
Yeah.
Well, it's controversial. Cyprus would claim that.
Cypriot brothers on the other side of the net.
All right, so let's wrap it. So. To wrap up, we've got...
Lions captain.
Oh, yeah, go on.
Lions captain,
who would it be?
Or come back to me.
I don't think
I'd go with Alan Wynn as well.
I can't think of it.
And the captain did in the last series. He did really well. So I think it'd be an Alan Wynn decision. Right.
Rory Best.
He's got his hand in the ring,
but you know, if Hartley was fit and... not disciplined, that's starting over Rory Best.
Alright, so...
Will Sips go to the Lions?
Don't
you think so?
He's not playing for England, he's not playing for Lions.
Sips
could be like a wig.
Who's coaching?
Weird, like,
who's got
rogue
Gatland,
isn't
he?
Yeah. But they say even like a Bendon might have a shot.
Who?
Manu Talanga?
Talanga.
What injury? What, we got to wrap up the whole thing now?
Yeah, we have to. That's
an hour. Yeah, but once you've done some medicine,
we can talk about as much as you want. No one's
Well, we can do it.
Can we do part one, part two? Can we do part one and part two?
Next week, next month. 1 minute.
All right, so to finish it off, we're going to put our Earthman Earth Trial of the Week. Video is here. Bristol Rugby.
Bristol,
lovely.
Great try, that is.
Decent.
Well done, Bristol.
All right. Well, last note, Carter, taking drugs?
No, he's not.
He's had a bit of a dip in form lately.
I'm so angry at the accusation that you would say something like that about the greatest player that's ever played the game.
I couldn't agree more.
Best ten to ever play the game, Dan Carter, and hands down, he's 35 years old. He's coming to the end of his career.
Say goodbye.
Like, comment, subscribe.
Islamic deal.
Follow us on our social media sites.
Follow
all the links below.
Phoenix, this
is going to be a regular thing. Hopefully, once every whenever we get bothered. So
yeah, and thank you very much to Raison D'etre for having our.
Thank you, Raison D'etre and Matthew.
For all
love you.
All
thank
these
you.
Cookies
and
sweets.
Drinks. Thank you.
And everything.
We'll be back.
Hashtag Free Carter.
Thank my nation.
Thank you very much.
Who's been on Brady's boys?
I couldn't carry on Dan Brady.
Ever?
Right,
Dan Carter, best fly half to ever play the game.
Brady Michelin.
Not Michelin.
Tariq's a better 10 than Michelin.
No, Michelin. I'm not actually a good 10.